395, 395 in your hymnal, I have a song that Jesus gave me. Let's all stand together as we sing. In my heart there rings a melody. On that verse together, I have a song that Jesus gave me. It was sent from heaven above. There never was a
singing, and good to see you in church today. And a little nippy, but that's okay. And the sun is out, and I'm glad you made it to the house of God this morning. Looking forward to a good service together today. And let's bow for prayer and ask God to meet with us. Father, we bow before you in prayer this morning. We thank you, Lord, for another Lord's Day that you brought us to. Thank you, Lord, that in our heart there rings a melody because Jesus Christ has come into our lives and has given us the gift of eternal life. And Lord, I pray that if any in this room today have never received Christ as their Savior, that today would be the day that they would accept his invitation to come unto him. And Lord, I pray that they would receive him as their Savior today. Lord, meet with us today. May you be pleased with all that's said and done in our service this morning. Bless the music. Bless our fellowship together, the giving of the tithe and the offering. And Lord, honor the preaching of your word today. Use it in each one of our lives, I pray in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. All right, you may be seated.
There's a new song in my heart since the Savior set me free. There's a new song in my heart. 'Tis a heavenly harmony. All my sins are washed away in the blood of Calvary. Oh, what peace and joy nothing can destroy. There's a new song in my heart. In my heart there rings a melody, there rings a melody with heaven's harmony. Jesus gave me, it was sent from heaven above. There never was a sweeter melody, 'tis a melody of love. In my heart there rings a melody, there rings a melody with heaven's harmony. In my heart there rings a melody, there rings a melody of love. Christ who died on Calvary, for he washed my sins away. He put within my heart a melody, and I know it's there to stay. In my heart there rings a melody, there rings a melody with heaven's harmony.
grab, ladies. 283. I have found his grace is all complete. He supplieth every need. You may remain seated as we sing 283. Joy unspeakable. Let's sing that first together. I have found his grace is all complete. He supplieth every need. While I sit and learn at Jesus' feet, I am free as free indeed. It is joy unspeakable and full of glory, full of glory, full of glory. It is joy unspeakable and full of glory. Oh, the half has never yet been told. I have found the pleasure I once dreamed. It is joy and peace within. What a wondrous blessing I have saved from the awful gulf of sin. It is joy unspeakable and full of glory. I have found a joy no tongue can tell, how its waves of glory roll. It is like a great o'erflowing well, springing up within my soul. It is joy unspeakable and full of glory, full of glory, full of glory. It is joy unspeakable and full of glory. Oh, the half
All right, now some announcements. Listen carefully, if you will. We have our regular schedule today of services. 5:30, we have a Christian growth class. We meet in the conference room right down across from our nursery at 5:30 tonight. We're going to continue a lesson we started last Sunday evening about tongues and healing. Some of the things that many churches put forth today about there's direct revelation, and we talked about that last week. What do you do when someone stands up and says, well, God has given me a message to give to you? Is that biblical or not? We talked about that last week and learned about how to respond to that. We'll talk about whether the tongues and the healing and what the Bible says about those things this evening in the class. That's open for anyone who'd like to come. Then 6:30 tonight, I'm looking forward to tonight's service. I want to talk to you tonight about this subject, walking with God or walking with God. What does that mean? What does that mean? You've been in church for a long time, or you've been in church for a while. You've heard people say, yeah, walk with God. And we say, amen, that's right. And then if somebody says, what does that mean? You're not quite sure. Mm-hmm. Is it just read your Bible and pray? Does that do it? I'm going to help you with that tonight. I'm excited about the service, and I want you to be back tonight. And we'll talk about walking with God. What does that look like? What does that mean? And I think that'll be our message this evening, all right? Then tomorrow night, ladies, you have your ladies' night out, Singing in the Rain. And tomorrow night, 6:30, it's $3.50 per person, and you get breakfast for dinner. How about that? And got a big breakfast planned for you, 6:30 tomorrow night. If you haven't signed up yet, there's still time. Just put your name on the list downstairs on the table, and look forward to having a great time tomorrow night. The ladies are over at the Fellowship Hall. And then reminder, next Sunday is Easter Sunday. It's Resurrection Sunday. Celebrate the resurrection of our Lord. And on Sunday evening, normal services Sunday morning, 9:30 and 10:30. And then Sunday night at 6:30, the choir will be doing God's Holy Lamb, a wonderful cantata and narration. And we'll have that at 6:30 on Sunday night. So invite some folks to come with you, and plan to be here to hear the choir that night. You'll enjoy that on next Sunday evening. Okay, we want to take a minute now. We'll welcome any guests that are with us in the service today. We're always pleased when folks visit with us in the service. If you're visiting today, or if you brought a guest with you, we'd love to meet you, find out who you are and where you're from. Okay, so if you're visiting today and not a member here at Bible Baptist Church, would you honor us by standing just for a moment? If you brought a guest, you can stand and introduce them today, and let's find out who you are and where you're from. Brother Adams, go ahead and introduce your family for us here, would you please?
Josiah, great.
The Adams are from New York, and they're just kind of passing through, and they stopped in to be in church today, and we appreciate them being here this morning. Amen. Never had to take a vacation from church. Amen. And it's good to have them. Right back here. Great. Good to have you this morning. Thank you for being in the service. Wonderful. Thank you. That's great. All right. Anyone else join these this morning? All right. If you'll take just a moment and fill out the welcome card, we would appreciate you doing that. And a little bit, we have the offering. Just drop that card in the plate, and we'll have a record of you being with us. And keep the pen. It's our gift to you for coming this morning. We're glad you're here. And let's give these folks a warm welcome, shall we?
Let's turn over to number 11. Number 11, long before the fall of man, God designed a master plan. He is mine. Number 11, let's sing that first all together.
Long before the fall of man, God designed a master plan. He exchanged the sinner for the sinless one. Jesus left his throne on high, came to earth to bleed and die. He said, Father, not my will, but thine be done.
we sing this last verse, let's have the children go out to junior church. You are dismissed out to junior church. On that last together, through God's mercy and His grace, He prepared for us a place. Words cannot describe the matchless beauty there. We will praise the perfect Lamb, King of kings, the great I am. He has made the joys of heaven ours to share. He is mine, He is mine. I am blessed beyond all measure, He is mine. I have pardon full and free through the blood He shed for me.
Let's all stand and sing that chorus one more time. Sing it like you mean it. He is mine on that chorus.
He is mine. He is mine. I am blessed beyond all measure. He is mine. I have pardon full and free through the blood He shed for me.
Singing. Let's go to 542. 542. 'Tis so sweet to trust in Jesus, just to take Him at His word. Let's sing that first all together.
'Tis so sweet to trust in Jesus, just to take Him at His word, just to rest upon.
And greet one another. Make somebody feel welcome, especially our guests. We'll come back and sing that last stanza together. is sweet to trust in Jesus, just from sin and self to cease, just from Jesus simply taking life and rest and joy and peace. Jesus, Jesus, how I trust him, how I prove to him more and more. Jesus, Jesus, precious Jesus, oh, for grace to trust him more. As you find your seats, let's sing that last together. I'm so glad I learned to trust thee, precious Jesus, Savior friend. When we get to the chorus, we'll have the instruments drop out. We'll sing that a cappella. On that last together, I'm so glad I learned to trust thee, precious Jesus, Savior friend. And I know that thou art with me, wilt be with me to the end. Jesus, Jesus, how I trust him, how I prove him more and more. Jesus, Jesus, precious Jesus, oh, for grace to trust him more.
All right, you can be seated. Great singing this morning. The ushers are coming, and we'll get our offering today. Give as God has blessed and prospered you. And if you have your welcome card, please put that in the offering when it goes by, if you would. And again, we're glad you're here with us this morning. And let's pray together for our offering. I'll ask Brother Abrams to lead us in our prayer today.
Lord and Heavenly Father, we come before you again today, Lord, to bless this offering and bless each gift and each giver. Lord, go up and down each aisle and each row and touch each heart. And Lord, put our pastor self behind and let God's word come through. Lord, we just want to give you thanks and glory and honor, all the things that you've done for us. And we love you, Lord. In Jesus' name, amen.
Please take your Bibles this morning for our scripture reading to Mark chapter 7, if you would, please. Mark chapter 7. Second book of the New Testament, Mark chapter 7. And we are going to read verses 31 through 37. We read these verses responsively, begin together on 31. I'll read 32. We'll alternate reading until we end together on verse number 37 of Mark chapter 7. As our custom is, let's stand together to read the scripture. All of us standing, please, to read God's word. And let's begin together on verse 31 of Mark chapter 7. Ready? And again, departing from the coasts of Tyre and Sidon, he came unto the sea of Galilee through the midst of the coast of Decapolis. And they bring unto him one that was deaf and had an impediment in his speech. And they beseech him to put his hand upon him. And he took him aside from the multitude and put his fingers into his ears. And he spit and touched his tongue. And he, looking up to heaven, he sighed and saith unto him, Ephphatha, that is, be opened. And straightway his ears were opened, and the string of his tongue was loosed, and he spake plain. And he charged them that they should tell no man. But the more he charged them, so much the more a great deal they published it, and were beyond measure astonished, saying, He hath done all things well. He maketh both the deaf to hear and the dumb to speak. And let's pray, shall we? Father, we ask you to add your blessing to the reading of our scripture here this morning. And I pray, Lord, that you would continue to make our hearts ready, that we'll be prepared to receive the word of God that you have for us today. Lord, we understand that you often speak to us in a still small voice. And so, Lord, I pray that you would help us to listen carefully today. You'll use the special now to quiet our hearts before you. And Lord, I pray that each of us would be ready to receive what the Spirit would say to each of our hearts this morning. May your will be done in Jesus' name. Amen.
Jesus is standing on Pilate's hall, friendless, forsaken, betrayed by all. Hearken, what meaneth the sudden call? What will you do with Jesus? What will you do with Jesus? Neutral you cannot be. Someday your heart will be asking, what will he do with me? Jesus is standing on trial still. You can be false to him if you will. You can be faithful through good or ill. What will you do with Jesus? Will you evade him as Pilate tried? Or will you choose him whatever betide? Vainly you struggle from him to hide. What will you do with Jesus? What will you do with Jesus? Neutral you cannot be. Someday your heart will be asking, what will he do with me? Jesus, I give thee my heart today. Jesus, I'll follow ye all the way. Gladly obeying thee will you say, this will I do with Jesus. What will you do with Jesus? Neutral you cannot be. Someday your heart will be asking, what will he do with
Thank you, ladies. Father, we bow before you in prayer now as we come to the preaching of your word. Father, I pray that if any in this room today are, they'd ponder the question, what have they done with Christ? What have they done with Jesus, which is called the Christ? Because one day they'll be asking, what will he do with me? Lord, I pray that they would realize that now is the accepted time. Behold, today is the day of salvation. Lord, my prayer this morning is if they've never received Christ as their Savior, that they would not put off another day. They would not boast themselves of tomorrow, for we know not what a day may bring forth. And I pray today they'd receive Christ as their Savior. And I pray, Lord, that you would meet with us now in these next few moments as we look into the only book you've ever written. We desire that you speak to our hearts and help us to understand and glean the truth that we have from your word today. And Spirit of God, please use it in our hearts and lives. Make us better Christians because we were in church this morning. Help us to be doers of the word and not hearers only. So speak to us and help us in these next few minutes together. In Jesus' name, amen. How many of you remember a television show? I don't think it's still on. It might be. It used to be Home Makeover or something like that, where they would, you know, have some older, broken-down house, and its family would be chosen, and then they'd be sent away on a trip for a week or so, and I think it a week somewhere, and they would go away on a vacation, and meanwhile, all these people would descend on this house and totally make it over. And remember, when they'd bring the family back, they'd always pull them up, and they had the big bus sitting in front of the house, and they'd pull that family up on the other side of the bus, and they'd tell one of the family members to yell at the bus driver, and what would he yell? Move that bus. You've seen the show, I can tell. And what's that scripture say? No, never mind. Move that bus. And boy, that bus would go, and then they would just freak out, wouldn't they? And they'd scream, and some would cry, and they'd just get all excited. They can't believe the change in that house. They can't believe what has taken place. And they're overwhelmed with excitement. They're overwhelmed with joy that somebody would do this for them. And they're excited about it. That's where these people were that you read about in Mark chapter 7. Jesus has come to them, and he takes a man that couldn't speak. He couldn't hear. Well, he could speak, but he spoke with an impediment. You couldn't understand him very well because he was deaf. He couldn't hear. And, you know, we have a grandson, Nandy and Nikki's little boy, Drew, and he's at that age where you say a word and then he repeats the word. You know, we learn to talk by what we hear. And so Dean never heard, so he would talk, but his words weren't very plain. They were hard to understand him. And now Jesus comes and he takes this man aside, and when he brings him back, the guy can not only hear everything, he talks plain too. And the Bible says in verse 37, they were beyond measure astonished. I mean, they couldn't believe what they just saw. And they're excited about it. When's the last time you were just amazed at what somebody did for you or something that happened to you? I mean, beyond excited, you were just going crazy. You didn't know what to do. You didn't know how to contain yourself. That's where these people were. They're excited. It was that kind of a day. Now listen, we live in that kind of a day today. And what I mean by that is people live by their feelings. People live by their feelings. It's rare to hear anybody say, what do you think about that? You know what they ask? What do you feel about that? I know your feelings. So-and-so said this. What do you feel about that? And so we have to be careful about, we begin to think it's our God-given right to feel happy. We believe it's our God-given right to be happy. Therefore, if our marriage fails, why did this happen to me? If a child rebels, why did this happen to me? If we get the pink slip at work, why did this happen to me? God, what are you doing? Now, privately, if not publicly, we can begin to complain to God about how we're being treated. But however, if there's food on the table, and I have a job to go to, and I'm getting a paycheck, and I got my health to be able to enjoy it all, God sure is good. See? God sure is good. But if there's health problems and a cash flow struggle and marriage or family issues, then it's, I don't know why God's doing this to me. I don't know why I'm going through this. Devil's really after me. I want to establish a principle with you this morning. And this principle is this: God loves me. And that's not just me. He loves you. Say that together. God loves me. God loves you. And by the way, God loves you unconditionally. And what's that mean? It means He doesn't place, well, I love you if you do this and if you live this way or if you do that way. No. God loves you. End of the discussion. He loves you no matter what. That means there's no conditions to His love. And what He desires is that we love Him that way in return. That we love Him unconditionally. Romans 8:28. How many of you know what Romans 8:28 says? Okay. For we know that all things work together for good to them that love God, to them who are the called according to His purpose. Hey, you did that about as well as you did move that bus. That was good. And now, we know that if all things work together for good, are all things good? No, obviously not. Not if He has to work them together for good. So not all things that happen are good. But I don't live for God because everything will be good. And I don't live for God because I'll be happy. And I don't live for God because everything will turn out right. I live for God because I love God. Period. I love God and He loves me. And that's to live for God at Romans 12, it's my reasonable service. Just reasonable because He loves me like that, I ought to live for Him. That's just reasonable. Now these people, they thought God did all, their statement was, He doeth all things well. Why? Because He maketh the deaf to hear and the dumb to speak. Hey, He does all things well because we like what He's done. Does He still do all things well if you don't like what He's done? That's easy to say, but it's harder to live, isn't it? What about Paul, who he didn't heal? Paul said 3 times, I had a thorn in the flesh, and 3 times I asked God to remove it, and God said, no. You're going to live with that. How about, hey, you know what? It's all going to work out for good. It's all going to be good for you. Tell that to John the Baptist. How'd that work for him? He got his head cut off. Is God still? Hey, does He still do all things well? Yeah, He does. And I want to help you. Give you several thoughts here this morning. Number one, we cannot determine good and bad. We cannot determine good and bad. We understand that. We should understand that. How many of you have children in your home? You've had children in your home, or you currently have children in your home that are 5 and under. Anybody like that? And all of you, if you have older kids, they were one time 5, okay, or under. You give them a choice. You don't get up in the morning and say, "What would you like to eat for breakfast?" Candy. Sure. What would you like for breakfast? Ice cream. Sure. I know. Brett Linke says, what's wrong with that?
Yeah, listen. We know that the child doesn't know what's good for him. Now, sometimes, by the way, sometimes they can do what's good. Nikki, come over. It must have been Thursday night, I think it was. And they had dinner, and Drew was there, and I guess for dessert, you ready for this? Dessert, my wife offered their child. And I choose those words carefully. Cookies are grapes. And he said, grapes. Pray for them that they'll bring him up in the way that he needs to go. That must be his mother's influence. And the problem is, he loves fruit. He loves grapes especially. You know what, though? The problem is he doesn't know when to stop. As long as you put him in front of him, he's... And he does. He puts them on in there and gets big cheeks and... They just keep on eating. And I think my wife relayed the story. She said, I looked at him and said, I think I better stop. Or why? He'll get sick. He doesn't know what's good or what's bad for him. They just keep on going. That's the way a child is. Now listen to me. We're God's children. It is awful difficult when your child thinks he knows something that's good for him and you know it isn't good for him. That it's going to hurt him. The people of Israel, when they were, and I call them the people of Israel, because I know one time a child got home from church and he asked Dad, you know, the pastor's talking about children of Israel this, children of Israel that. Didn't the adults ever do anything? When we say the children of Israel, they weren't mean all little kids, all right? And so since I was just talking about children, I thought I better use people of Israel. They got out, and you know, remember what they talked about? They talked about going back to Egypt. Oh, better for us to go back to Egypt than die here in the wilderness. Give me a question. Was that good for them to go back? No. They didn't know what was good for them. To obey God was what they needed to do. The prodigal son said, hey, Dad, give me my inheritance. I'm ready for it. I'm ready to take it on. I know what I'm doing. I'm ready to live my life. I don't need these rules. I don't need this home. I don't need you guys watching over me, knowing where I am all the time. I'm ready to take on that responsibility. Was he? No. We know the rest of the story now, don't we? He wasn't ready. Eve listened to the devil. Thought it would be a good idea to eat of the fruit of the tree of the knowledge of good and evil. Was that a good idea? No. But she thought it was. Principle. God knows what's best for me. God knows what's best for me. I don't know what's best for me. God knows what's best for me. In all thy ways, acknowledge Him. He shall direct thy path. God knows what's best for me. And I want Him to direct my path. I want Him to direct my steps. I want Him to be in control. What I think may be good may not be good for me at all. I don't want to make that decision. I want God to make that decision. What I think may be bad maybe just what I need. How many of you grew up in a home where mom and dad spanked you? Let me see your hand. Wow, look at that. Okay. How many of you thought when you on the receiving end of some of those, you said, boy, this is really good for me? No. In fact, you'd have said, this is bad for me. Now, let's look back, and how many of you say, you know what? It was good for me. Look at that. Though we thought it was bad at the time, now we know it was good. And so, I'm not going to trust myself to know what's good or bad. I'm going to let God determine what's good or bad. And by the way, He's done that. That's why he gave us the book. Okay? This tells us what's good and what's bad. Number two, our second thought this morning. Do not serve God because things will be good. Serve God because you love Him. Do not serve God because things are good. Serve God because you love Him. Look at the last book of the Old Testament. The last book of the Old Testament. It's Malachi. Looks like Malachi, but it's Malachi. Chapter 3. Malachi chapter 3, please. Malachi asks the people of Israel a question here in verse number 8. And he asks, will a man rob God? Yet ye have robbed me. But ye say, wherein have we robbed thee? In tithes and offerings. Ye are cursed with a curse. For ye have robbed me, even this whole nation. Bring ye all the tithes into the storehouse, that there may be meat in mine house. And prove me now herewith, saith the Lord of hosts, if I will not open you the windows of heaven and pour you out a blessing, that there shall not be room enough to receive it. How many of you believe those verses are true? Okay? They're in the Bible. They're true. Okay? So you hear, and preachers have preached, all right, you tithe, you give God what's His, you don't rob God, listen, and God will open the windows of heaven and pour you out a blessing, there won't be room enough to receive. What if He doesn't? What if you tithe and the car breaks down and you got a $2,000 repair bill? See? What do you tithe and something breaks at the house and you have to get something repaired at the house? If the windows don't open, you give the Lord His tithe anyway. It's His. Still not going to rob God. And by the way, I'm not just giving. By the way, there is a principle of giving and receiving. No doubt about it. It's all through the Bible. And God, listen, and the principle is you won't outgive God. I'll guarantee that. But if I didn't get anything, I'd still tithe. Why? Because I love God. I love God. That's why I'm giving. I'm giving because, well, now preacher, they're going to take away the deduction and you're not going to be able to deduct it on your income taxes anymore. That really doesn't bother me a whole lot. I'm not giving for a deduction. I'm giving because I love God. And that's, listen, that's the motivation of everything you do. Sometimes people show up in church, and maybe that's your case this morning. You know, things go bad in somebody's life. So, well, I better go to church this week. It's kind of like pulling out the rabbit's foot or pulling out the, you know, I better do something. I had a bad week or I've been very good. I better get to church. No, you come to church. Why? Because you love Him. You want to get up, what'll cause you to get up in the morning and open your Bible and spend time reading His Word and talking to Him is because you love Him. You do what you do out of a love for Christ. The devil's accusation of Job was just that, wasn't it? Oh yeah, Job loves you because you put a hedge of protection around him. Nothing bad has ever happened to Job. He's got money, he's got livestock, he's got family, he's got houses, he's got riches, he's got everything. Let me at him and he'll curse you to your face. Let's see how Job's going to react when it doesn't go all his way. Let's see if Job will still say, yeah, he does all things well. Satan says, I'll put my money on, he won't. And God said, go ahead. You know the story of Job, and he lost everything in one day. 7 children, his business, his livestock, everything gone. You know what Job said? The Lord gave, and the Lord hath taken away. Blessed be the name of the Lord. Don't you think Satan went, you've got to be kidding me. He's not supposed to do that. In all this, it says, Job never sinned with his lips nor charged God foolishly. Most of us probably couldn't say that. Job did. Touched his body, gave him boils. He was in misery. And Job looked up and Satan's waiting for him to curse God and to be upset with God and mad at God. And Job looked and he said, you know what? Though he slay me, yet will I trust him. And Satan said, what do you do with a guy like that? I can't do anything with him. He's set on loving God no matter what. By the way, how'd that work out for Job? Pretty well, didn't it? In the end, he got twice as much as he had before. God honored that and God blessed that. I think of Joseph, who was hated by his brothers, thrown into a pit, sold as a slave, rose up in Potiphar's house to be in charge of all of his house and over all the servants that were there, falsely accused by Potiphar's wife, thrown in prison for 3 years, thinking he's going to get out. And butler and the baker, and they get out, and the baker gets executed, and the butler says, I'll remember you. 2 years go by, and he forgets to ever say anything. Until Pharaoh has a dream, and he doesn't know what it means. Then the butler remembers and says, oh, wait a minute. There's a guy in prison who could tell dreams. And of course, Joseph gets out. And he tells Pharaoh the dream, and he gets promoted to second in all the country underneath Pharaoh. Let me ask you a question. Joseph had the dream originally that he was the one that everybody else is bowing down to. The next thing that takes place is he's in a pit looking up at everybody, waiting for some period of time, hoping that it's his brothers who come back to the pit and not some wild animal that falls into the pit. Screaming, and the Bible seems to indicate there's some great anguish that he went through when he was in that pit. You can understand. It was his life. And then finally he's relieved. They get him out of the pit, but he's not so relieved because there's slave traders there and they sell him to the slave traders. And he's taking several hundred miles away to Egypt, to a land where he doesn't understand the language, and they don't understand them, they don't understand him. Boy, how's that dream working out for you now? You still want to talk about how great God is, Joe? Still want to say he does all things well, Joe? How did Joseph, he stayed, when he got to Potiphar's house, he was faithful. He did what God wanted him to do. He served that guy just like he was his Lord. And he rose. When he got into the prison, he did the same thing. He could have been upset. He could have had the bad attitude. He was falsely accused. He didn't do anything wrong. I know you get into prison. We're there Thursday and Saturday. I know. Everybody's innocent. There's a few guys who know I'm here and I deserve to be here. But there's guys who always think, they set me up, or they ratted on me, or they sold me down the river, or, you know, they're still blaming everybody else. But Joseph rightfully shouldn't have been there. But you know what he did? He was so faithful and so honest and so godly, he promoted him into prison. Whatever went on in the prison, Joseph was the guy who did it. And eventually, when he gets to be next to Pharaoh, his brothers end up coming down. You know the story. And his brothers are all upset after dad dies that Joseph's finally going to react vengeance or give some vengeance on them. And Joseph says, hey, fellas, quit worrying about it. Genesis 50, verse 20, he said, you meant it for evil, but God meant it for good. God meant it for good. There's things that happen in our life. Listen, Joseph kept serving God because he loved God. Not because he understood everything was going on along the way. I'm sure he didn't. And listen, my friend, you're not going to live very long on this earth to where some things are going to come into your life, some things are going to happen in your life, and you're going to say, I don't understand this. I don't understand why this happened. God, I don't begin to know why this took place. My wife was sharing with me, ran into some high schoolers from Hamilton High School, I think it was, and one of their friends, 17-year-old young man. And his brother cracked his back or walked on his back, you know, and he got up, and I think soon after that they noticed a couple red spots on his chest. Thought, that's weird. Went to the doctor, they did the x-rays, and found out he had fourth-stage cancer. 17 years old. Within a matter of 2 months, I think it was, he's dead. Gone. 17 years old. You say, how do you explain that? I can't explain that. But I know this. You still serve God because you love Him. And I can't determine good or bad. Only God can. I'm going to trust that He does all things well. That's easy when you're looking at the guy who was healed. It's not so easy when you look at the guy who didn't get healed. It's easy to say when you're spared from the accident. It's not so easy to say when you're not spared from the accident. When your loved one escapes and they lived, but what about when your loved one didn't escape and they died? Then you find out, am I living for God because of what He does for me? Or am I living for God because I love Him? No strings attached. Life is not all sunshine and roses. Serve God anyhow. Life is not all smiles and laughs. Serve God anyhow. Life is not all smooth sailing and clear waters. Serve God anyhow. We can't determine good or bad. We don't serve God because things are good. We serve God because we love Him. Number three, how you view the circumstances of your life depends on your relationship with God. We said Romans 8:28 earlier, we know that all things work together for good to them that love God, to them who are called according to His purpose. They all work together to them that love God. That's an important part of that verse. Matthew 23 and verse number 37, Jesus said, the greatest commandment of all is you should love the Lord your God with all your heart, all your soul, all your mind, and all your strength. That's the very first commandment. So I have to view everything. I have to view everything that happens in life through the glasses of an unconditional love for God. That I love Him unconditionally, and He loves me unconditionally. I believe that's how Job could say, blessed be the name of the Lord. I believe that's how Joseph could say, well, you meant it for evil, but God meant it for good. And He knows what's best. As a parent, would you do anything to intentionally hurt or bring pain to your child? No, you would not. You would not do anything. You would harm your child. Don't you think God's a better parent than we are? So I trust that even though some things cause me pain, even though some things seem to be bad to me, I'm going to trust that God knows best. And when I get to see from His perspective, I'll say He does all things well. He does all things well. Charles Weigel was an evangelist. He came home from a meeting after being in evangelism for several years. And he came home and called for his wife, and there was no answer. And when he walked into the kitchen of their little apartment where they were staying, there was a note on the kitchen table saying that she did not want to live the life of a wife of an evangelist. She didn't want to live the life that that called for. And that she had taken their little daughter and she's gone. Don't try to find me. Don't come after me. I want the world. I want the city life. I want the lights. I want to have fun. Charles Weigel did not know what to do. He cried. He wept. But he said he determined that day that he would go on for God. He prayed. And he said, I went to the next campaign. And by his own words, he says, I preached 2 weeks and never gave an invitation. Back in those days, and in those, I think this was probably in the 1950s, 1940s, you could go to a meeting. They would hold extended meetings like that. Imagine 2 weeks preaching the Word of God, preaching the gospel, not giving an invitation. He said, then Sunday morning, the second Sunday morning of the meeting, after 2 weeks of preaching, he said, I gave an invitation and 300 came forward to receive Christ as their Savior. Sunday evening, they came back and I gave the invitation again on Sunday evening and 200 more came forward. And he said, the men came to me and they said, we've never seen anything like this. This has never happened before. And he told them, he said, it's the Lord. It's God answering prayer. And by the way, he goes on to say 3 years after his wife left him, she was dead. He was at his home in Florida, and he sat down at his piano, and he just got to talking to the Lord, and he said, Lord, there's no one like you. You're so kind and you're so loving. And he wrote a song as he sat at his piano. He said, I wrote the entire song in 20 minutes. It's the song, No One Ever Cared For Me Like Jesus. If you're not familiar with it, it goes like this. I would love to tell you what I think of Jesus. Since I found in Him a friend so strong and true. I would tell you how He changed my life completely. He did something that no other friend could do. No one ever cared for me like Jesus. There's no other friend so kind as He. No one else could take the sin and darkness from me. Oh, how much He cares for me. My friend, if you're here and you don't know Christ as your Savior, there's no one like Jesus. There's no one who can take the sin and darkness from you except Jesus Christ. The next verse says, all my life was full of sin when Jesus found me. All my heart was full of misery and woe. Jesus placed His strong and loving arms around me and He led me in the way I ought to go. Then he wrote, every day He comes to me with new assurance. More and more I understand His words of love. But I'll never know just why He came to save me. Till someday I see His blessed face above. No one ever cared for me like Jesus. Wow. And I think if you'd ask Charles Weigel, listen, you would look at his life and say, well, that's a bad thing that his wife left him. And by the way, in our eyes, that's bad. But what does Romans 8:28 say? God worked it together for good. We wouldn't have No One Ever Cared For Me Like Jesus if that hadn't happened. God worked it together for good. And my friend, listen to me. Wife, the best friend you ever have isn't your husband. The best friend you ever have is Jesus Christ. Husband, the best friend you ever have isn't your wife. I cringe at times when husbands say, oh, my wife, she's our rock. She's the rock of the family. You better have Jesus Christ as the rock of your family. He's the one. And by the way, every wife ought to say amen to that. Ron Hamilton was 19, he was 27 years old in 1978. On a routine visit to the eye doctor, something unusual discovered in his left eye. After several weeks of testing, they determined that he'd have to have surgery to remove a tumor in his eye. Emory University in Atlanta, Georgia, and they would not know until he came out of surgery whether they could remove the tumor or whether they'd have to take the whole eye. When he came out of surgery, his wife gave him the news. She said, "The doctor found cancer. Your left eye is gone." Well, the doctor gave him his eye patch, and he said, "I wore it to church." And kids were fascinated by the patch over his eye. Everywhere I went, he said, children would call out to the embarrassment of their mothers, "Look, Mom, there goes a pirate." He said a child came up to him after the service and asked if I was a pirate. And I said, "Well, I guess I am. I guess you can call me Patch the Pirate." And Patch the Pirate was born. Now, wow, almost, well, 38 years. Our kids grew up with Patch the Pirate. Now there's a nationwide broadcast, The Adventures of Patch the Pirate. All of the blessing that came from that. Because, oh, how terrible. You lost an eye. You think Ron Hamilton would say that was bad? You think he'd say that was good? Luther Bridges. It was 1910. About 7 years after his marriage, he too was an evangelist, and he accepted an invitation told a two-week revival meeting that was just a few hours away from his wife's parents' home in Kentucky. He left his wife and three small boys at her parents' home and went over to the town to hold services. It was a great revival. Many people were receiving Christ as their Savior. Near the end of the revival services, he got a late-night, long-distance phone call. He wondered who could be calling at this hour. What could possibly be wrong? And it was hard for a 26-year-old Luther Bridges to take in the full impact of the call. His wife's parents' home had caught fire and burned to the ground, and his wife and three sons had perished in the fire. He was bereaved for his wife and for his children, and he did ask himself, how could this happen when I was serving God? He was stunned and inactive for a little time. The Lord began to speak to him again about evangelism, and he began to prepare himself again through prayer and study. And he said, "I stopped asking God why, and the Lord spoke to me through His Word. He said, 'I read, the Lord is my portion, saith my soul, and He that dwelleth in the secret place of the Most High shall abide in the shadow of the Almighty.'" And he thought to himself, the secret place, the shadow, the presence of the Almighty, I can trust God. The God of all the earth will not forsake me or fail me. And he penned these words, "There's within my heart a melody. Jesus whispers sweet and low. Fear not, I am with thee. Peace, be still. In all of life's ebb and flow. Jesus, 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 sweetest name I know. Fills my every longing, keeps me singing as I go." That's by a man who lost his wife and three children in a fire. He writes the second verse, "All my life was wrecked by sin and strife. Discord filled my heart with pain. Jesus swept across the broken strings and stirred the slumbering chords again." How about that? Jesus took our transgressions. He took our sins and our sorrows. He made them His very own. And He went to Calvary and He suffered and He bled and He died on the cross. He died for my sins. He died for your sins. You have to receive Him as your Savior. Luther added in verse 3, feasting on the riches of His grace, resting neath His sheltering wing, always looking on His smiling face, that is why I shout and sing. Wow. But he also wrote this, sometimes He leads through waters deep and trials fall across the way. Notice, though sometimes the path seems rough and steep, see His footprints all the way. He said, I see God in it now. But I like the way he ended that song. Soon He's coming back to welcome me, far beyond the starry sky. I shall wing my flight to worlds unknown. I shall reign with Him on high. Jesus, 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 sweetest name I know. My friend, if you don't know Jesus, receive Him as your Savior today. One more and I'll close. Most of you, if you ever go through the hymn book, you'll see many songs by Fanny Crosby. She was an amazing hymn writer. 8,000 hymns she wrote in her lifetime. What you don't know maybe about Fanny Crosby is she was a blind lady. Blinded at just a few months of age by the mistake of a doctor. He applied some salve to her eyes that was the wrong kind of salve, and it blinded her. And that would be reason enough to be bitter. Reason enough to say, why did this happen to me? Why did God have this take place in my life? But she wasn't that way. She said later in life, I thank God I was blind, or I never would have written the many songs and hymns God gave me. She also said, I thank God that I'm blind because the first face I'll ever see will be the face of my Savior, Jesus Christ. One of the hymns that she wrote was called All the Way My Savior Leads Me. All the way my Savior leads me. What have I to ask beside? Can I doubt His tender mercy who through life has been my guide? Heavenly peace, divinest comfort, here by faith in Him to dwell. Listen, for I know whate'er befall me, Jesus doeth all things well. For I know whate'er befall me, Jesus doeth all things well. He doeth all things well. Heavenly Father, take the truth this morning. Use it in the hearts and lives of people today. Lord, I pray that folks here this morning, first of all, Lord, if any in the room have never received Christ as their Savior, that today would be the day. They would call upon the name of the Lord. And You'd give them the gift of eternal life through Jesus Christ. I pray for those who are saved here this morning. They have received You as their Savior. That God, today they determine, I'm not going to determine good or bad in my life anymore. I'm going to realize that's God's department. There's some today that need to make the decision, I'm not going to live for God because everything will be all right. I'm going to live for God because I love Him. And I pray, Lord, that their view of God, that all of us would look at the circumstances of life through the glasses of Your unconditional love for us. We see that You can work all things together for good. Whether it's the death of a loved one, whether it's a physical ailment, the loss of an eye, the loss of sight. Whatever it may be, God, You still desire that we glorify Your name through that. Help us to be like Job. And whether You give or whether You take away, we say, blessed be the name of the Lord. Our heads are bowed, our eyes are closed. I'll finish the prayer in just a moment. We'll have her invitation. I wonder how many folks are here this morning that would say, Pastor, if I died today, I know 100% sure that I would go to heaven. Pastor, there's a time in my life when I knew I was lost and I needed a Savior. Jesus was the Savior I needed, and I called on Jesus, and I've trusted Him as my personal Savior. I know Jesus is my Savior. Would you slip your hand up as a testimony for a moment that I may see it? Say, Pastor, that's me. All right, you may put them down. You're here today and would say, Pastor, I'm not sure. I have no idea if I died whether I'd go to heaven or I'd go to hell. But Pastor, I'm concerned about it. I would like to go to heaven. And believe me, you'd like to go to heaven. If you're here today and say, Pastor, please pray for me. Nobody will call you out. Nobody will embarrass you, but I will pray for you. Would you slip your hand up and put it back down and just say, Pastor, pray for me this morning? I'm not certain. God bless you. God bless you. Thank you. Appreciate your honesty today. Is there others who would join these? Say, Pastor, pray for me. Just slip it up and put it back down. I'll see it. Wonder how many believers here this morning would say, Pastor, God spoke to my heart today. I need to come to the point in my life where I can say, He doeth all things well. And Pastor, God has dealt with me. The Spirit of God has spoken to my heart. There's some decisions that I need to make. Pastor, pray for me this morning. Will you slip your hand up, Christian? Yes. Yes. Amen. All right, you may put them down. In a moment, I'm going to pray and we'll have your invitation. If you slipped your hand up this morning, and even if you didn't, and you don't know Christ as your Savior, in a moment I'll pray. When I'm done praying, we'll stand to our feet, the pianist will begin to play, Bob will sing, we'll have our invitation. At that time, Christians are going to come forward, and they're going to use the altar at the front here and pray. What you should do is you should slip from your seat, meet me right down here at the front, and let someone take a Bible, take you aside, and show you from the Bible how you can know Jesus as your Savior today. Oh, I wouldn't go out the door and go out on the highway not knowing that if somebody crossed the center line and hit me head on, that I'd go into eternity without Christ. I'd want to settle that. And so when others are coming, would you come? I'll meet you at the front. We'll have someone take a Bible, and they'll show you how you can know for sure you're on your way to heaven. Christian, God has spoken to your heart. You're moving and you're responding will help others to respond. Respond to what the Lord's told you to do today. Heavenly Father, bless this invitation now. Thank you for speaking to hearts this morning. And Lord, I'm praying for these who lifted their hand and said they're not certain if they died they'd go to heaven. I pray that they would step out on the very first note that the piano hits. They'd slip from their seat into the nearest aisle and they'd walk down to the front and let someone take a Bible and show them how they can come to know Jesus Christ as their Savior. They can walk out the door in a few minutes with the assurance in their heart they have eternal life. I pray for the believers that lifted their hand up, and I pray that you'd help them to do what you're telling them to do in their heart today. May holy decisions be made for thee this morning, and I'll thank you for it. Quietly with your heads bowed, you stand to your feet. As you stand to your feet, the pianist plays. As she plays, Brother Bob's going to sing. God has spoken to your heart. Respond to Him now. That's right.
Leads me. What have I to ask beside? Can I doubt His tender mercy, who through life has been my guide? Heavenly peace, divinest comfort, here by faith in Him to dwell. For I know whate'er befall me, Jesus doeth all things well. For I know whate'er befall me, Jesus doeth all things well. All the way my Savior leads me, cheers each winding path I tread. Gives me grace for every trial, feeds me with the living bread. through my weary steps may falter, and my soul athirst may be, gushing from the rock before me, lo, a spring of joy I see. Gushing from the rock before me, lo, a spring of joy I see.
Still time to come as he sings this morning. Several have come and they're being dealt with now for salvation. Should you come?
That's right. Love, perfect rest to me is promised in my Father's house above. When my spirit clothed immortal wings its flight to realms of day, this my song through endless ages, Jesus led me all the way. This my song through endless ages, Jesus led me all the way.
Look this way for a minute, if you would. We have four this morning that are being dealt with for salvation. Isn't that good? And we want to give them time to do that. We're not going to rush them at all. We'll let them deal with these folks about their soul. And you pray as you go that the Lord will open their heart and they'll be saved this morning. That's good, isn't it? And you know, you don't know. I know some things as I look through this crowd, and I know what some of you deal with, have dealt with in your life, and what you're dealing with now. I know that it's easy preaching to say he does all things well. But if you'll practice it, and I know some of you in this room who you believe that with all your heart, even though you're going through some deep waters, he does all things well. And you serve him, and you're here today only because you love him. And that's a great testimony. And it's been a good, I'm glad I came to church today. And I hope you are too. It's been a good day in the house of the Lord. Let's pray together, shall we? Father, we thank you for a wonderful morning this morning. I'm praying for these who have come forward and asked to receive Christ as their Savior, that, Lord, you'll open their heart to the gospel, and they'll receive Jesus Christ as their Savior. You'll give them the gift of eternal life. And Lord, I pray they'd remember this day forever, and it would be a change in their life, a wonderful change, because Jesus has come into their life. And Father, I pray now that you'll dismiss us with your care, that you'll give us a good afternoon. Prepare prepare our hearts what you have for us this evening and bring us back tonight for the evening service. It's in Jesus' name I pray. Amen. Amen. 6:30 tonight. Remember, we'll talk about walking with God and what that looks like. And you've got every Christian ought to learn to walk with God. And I want to help you this evening. I hope you'll be back for that service at 6:30, okay? All right. Ladies, don't forget, you sign up for the ladies' night out tomorrow night. There's a sign-up sheet for that downstairs on the table, okay? I'm so glad I'm a part of the family of God. Brother Bob?
I'm so glad I'm a part of the family of God. I've been washed in the fountain, cleansed by His blood, joined hands with Jesus as we travel this sod. For I'm a part of the family of God. Amen. You are dismissed. We'll see you tonight.